give a dog a bone. Yo, don't give him nothing but a microphone. Don't stop, I'm not finished yet. You said I'm not the E, you wanna make a bet. Remember this lounge, you in the danger zone. I figured you would, now leave me alone. You pick and you whisp on the four leaf clover to be the E double E. Over and over, you intrigued by the way I do my thing.
Do what?
You got the mic high and make a swing.
I have the capability to rap and chill. Coax and tax MCs who tend to act ill. It's like a dig 'em smack. You smack me and I'll smack your back. I get goosebumps when the baseline thumps. A sucker MC on ride. Now it's time for lunch. When I'm cooling on the scene, I notice one thing, I'm not bound. So sucking MCs clean. I consider myself better than average. Yo, I rock the mic like a wild beast savage.
I'm in the boggling state, I can't concentrate. I make a move like chess, and I yell checkmate. You know why I get zania and zania? Because of the PMD main. And when I walk through the crowd, I can see heads turning. I hear voices saying that's Eric's sermon. Not only from the women, but from the men. You know what? It feels good, my friend.
I'm the P double E, the thriller of Manila. Better known as the MC Cold Killer. TMT's goal is to keep the place jumping. And if not, we feel we owe you something. It's like Lotto, you have to be in it to win.
Y'all, this SlabOGsTV. Today we got another OG in here today. WB of WB's Auto Sales, aka Warren B, WB, you know, whatever you want to call it. First question I want to ask, you know, I want to ask you where you from.
Man, I'm from Parker Road, on the dead end of Parker Road in Cindy Woods. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's where I grew up.
Okay, Cindy Woods. So how was Cindy Woods back then?
How was Cindy Woods?
Yeah.
Man, it was all right. Yeah, yeah, you know, it was a place to be. You know, it was a nice neighborhood. You know, back then it was laid out, but it was a good neighborhood, good area to grow up in. You know, you had Cindy Woods, Fontaine, yeah. Northwood Manor. You had Rosewood down on the other end of Homestead. Mm-hmm. So it was just a good place to be. Yeah, okay. Cindy Woods was all right.
And then, you know, having Homestead being, it's a lot of neighborhoods on Homestead. So it was like everybody over there, you know, each neighborhood, everybody was kind of close and stuff like that.
Each neighborhood kind of did their own thing. I wouldn't say we was close, because if you went to Northwood, you had friends from Northwood Manor and Fontaine and Cindy Woods. Mm-hmm. So it really just depended on, you know, what high school or what middle school you was on to go to. Mm-hmm. But basically, we was all cool. Mm-hmm. You know, in so many words, you can say that.
Okay. And just, you know, just from knowing now, Homestead is an area where, you know, you're going to always see body shops everywhere, paint shops, tent shops, you know, just a bunch of fixed up cars riding up and down the street all day. So just tell me, like, who influenced you from just cars, just seeing cars just back in the day?
When I think about that, it was probably I probably had a lot of different influences. Mm-hmm. But when I really think about who actually influenced me, when I really have to think about it, you know, it's kind of ironic. I would probably say my daddy. And I would say the reason why I would say he probably influenced me, when I was probably in middle school, he purchased the 84 Oldsmobile Toronado.
That's so, the one that looked like the Eldorado, right?
Yeah. I mean, the Eldorado basically is, you know, you got GM products, you got Cadillac, you got Oldsmobile, you got Buick.
Okay.
So basically a Toronado would be a version, would basically be an Eldorado, but a cheaper version of it. Mm-hmm. So if you couldn't afford a Cadillac, then you can go get an Oldsmobile or a Buick. Mm-hmm. So I guess at that particular point in time, he couldn't afford a Cadillac, so he bought an Oldsmobile Toronado. Mm-hmm. And when he came to the house with that Oldsmobile Toronado, it had hubcaps on it. So back in the days, like if you had hubcaps on cars, they was worth money, because they was real metal hubcaps that had little keys to them and, you know, little emblems on them. So a set of hubcaps, I could imagine, I don't know what they cost back then, but maybe worth a couple of $100. Mm-hmm. So they stole them a lot.
Okay.
So back in the days when he bought the Oldsmobile Toronado and the hubcaps got stole, he was frustrated. So he didn't want to put hubcaps back on the car, because he didn't want the hubcaps to get stolen again. Mm-hmm. So he bought a brand new set of 84. You know, he bought some elbows at that point in time.
So
what we would call elbows, which was on the Cadillac Eldorado, he bought a set of brand new elbows, basically, and put on the Toronado.
And what year was this?
Probably 1984.
Dang. So, really, you know, he probably wasn't thinking of it or thinking that this was going to be a thing even a year or two later from there. He basically put a slab together way back in 84, really.
I mean, you could say that,
yeah,
but it was from the frustration of getting the hubcap stolen.
Yeah.
So instead of letting somebody pop these hubcaps off, I'm going to make them have to take the whole car because I'm going to put some wheels on the car. And I can imagine he had saw Eldorados with those wheels and they look good.
Okay.
So as a young guy, you know, as a youngster in middle school, I walk outside and see a 84 Oldsmobile Tornado with Vogue tires and spoke wheels on it. You know, it looked good.
I feel when you walked outside and saw it out there.
It was a midnight blue Oldsmobile Eldorado with a brand new set of wheels and tires on it.
Yeah.
It was a good looking car.
Yeah, and I'm sure in 84, it probably looked like, you know, now we look at it and we see like, okay, them elbows, you know, we've been seeing them for years, but to be in 84 and see them, it was just like, it's a new wheel. What kind of wheel is this? Like,
I wouldn't say it was like that because it was just a wheel.
Yeah.
So as a person at my age, you just walk outside, you just see a wheel. You don't think about what kind of wheel it is. You just say, hey, this is a good looking car. Car look good with these wheels and tires on it.
Okay.
So you get a chance to see, you know, a white wall tire with a gold stripe on it. It was a pretty wheel and it matched the car. So it was a good looking, automobile at that point in time.
Okay. How long did he ride it?
Well, what happened with that car, by it looking good, and it sat outside, so it wasn't parked in the garage, I don't remember how long it took, but it got stolen.
Mm-hmm. So the whole car
got stolen, so I can imagine for the wheels, and when you have a set of wheels like that, you need a set of locks on it.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a set of locks on the car, so he took the lock key, which you need the key to get the wheels off, so he took the lock key, put a coat hanger around the lock key, and hid the lock key inside the car.
Mm-hmm.
When he hid the lock key, when they stole the car, they needed the lock key to get the wheels off the car. So they took a lot of stuff loose looking for the lock key. So door panels, you know, took the trunk loose. They was looking for the lock key to take the wheels off the car. So when the insurance company got the car, gave us the car back, they put a new set of wheels and tires on it. But a lot of the other stuff was still not put back together right because the car had been stolen. And I guess he felt like one of us would feel, somebody steal your car, it came back, it didn't ride the same, it was pieces kind of hanging on the car that he didn't like that the insurance company didn't put back together good. So he wasn't happy with the car. So what he did with the car was did an insurance job on the car. So he got rid of the car. And the car was, basically he got rid of the car. And at that particular point, he got rid of it, then he bought another car.
Okay.
And the car he bought was an 85 Cadillac Coupe DeVille. And it came off the showroom floor at Tom Peacock Cadillac.
Okay. So during this time, like, what was the car scene like on Homestead and on the north side?
The car scene was, if you grew up in any neighborhood out here, you know, you had people in different, you know, every neighborhood, people had different cars in different neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm.
So the car scene was, you know, it was a good car scene as far as you would see fixed up cars, fixed up little trucks.
Mm-hmm.
So when we came up in school, there was a lot of guys fixing up cars and had nice looking cars and trucks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Chevy pickup trucks, you know, S10s. People was fixing up a lot of stuff. And, you know, elbows they were around, definitely. And back in those days, we used to go to Deuce & Park.
Mm-hmm.
So back when I was younger, Deuce & Park was the spot. So if you was a younger cat on Sundays and you was in high school, that was kind of the hangout spot to go to, basically go see, you know, people hanging out and you got a chance to see cars. The way Deucin is laid out, you know, it's one way in and then you got to go through the main drag and then you pass the lake and then you come out. So if you was at Deucin Park, the dream was to get you a car together so you can ride down the main lane of Deucin Park and everybody was going to be on each side looking at you coming down the road.
So it was kind of like a sport back then to put a car together.
I don't know because I was younger.
Yeah.
So I would say the guys that was fixing up cars or that had cars or that was making money, that was kind of the place to be. If you had any money, and when I say money, most of the time it would be somebody, you know, D-boys that was doing something that wasn't right, but they had money, they was able to fix cars up, put wheels on cars. So that was the place that you would go to showcase what you had. So if you had a nice car, you wanted to go showcase it, you was gonna ride to Deucin Park on Sundays.
Do you remember any of the cars from back then? There's one particular car that might have stuck out to you?
Man, I'm old.
Yeah.
The only car I can remember was somebody coming, I don't know who it was, but they rode through Deuce Park in an 84 Cadillac Eldorado. Mm-hmm. And I remember that car coming through that jam in Too Short.
Yeah.
And I forgot which Too Short song it was, but it was one of Too Short songs. And it was like, was nothing out there that day but that car coming through that lane.
Yeah.
And it was rolling. And I also remember a Cadillac Slantback.
Yeah.
I don't know who owned it, but I think the guy stayed in Crofton. But it had elbows on it with drill points. And if I remember right, it was white. It was clean.
Yeah.
So it was cars that I could remember, but you got to think we talking 30, 35 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. So can you tell me about your first car?
My first car was a 85 Cutlass Supreme. Mm. So when my dad and them bought the Cadillac from Tom Peacock, if you had an issue with your Cadillac, they would give you a Cutlass Supreme for a loaner car. So Cutlass Supremes, we had got a couple of loaner cars from the Cadillac dealership, and they was nice cars, mm-hmm. and they was clean cars. So back when I came up, Cutlasses and Regals was kind of the thing. So I always wanted a Cutlass.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't a hustler. A lot of people would think with me having this car lot, they might think I hustled, sold dope. Never sold dope, never hustled. That wasn't me, I worked. So my first car, I saved $4,500, and I wanted a Cutlass. I skipped school, went bought me a 40 ounce, went set at Tidwell Park, and I got an auto trader, and I flipped through auto trader, and I found an 85 Cutlass with a flood type. I forgot the exact price we paid for it, but I put $2,000 down, and I financed the rest, and that was my first car. And I took that old Cutlass, and I might have had it 8-9 months. I didn't have it as long as I wanted to have it, but I spent every dollar that I made on that Cutlass.
What was the aesthetics of it? Like, what did it look like? How did you put it together?
That Cutlass was dark burgundy.
Yeah.
It was burgundy Cutlass, burgundy interior. Mm-hmm. It was clean. Back in them days, people was kind of putting different color tops on the car. Mm-hmm. So if you had a green car, white top, it had a contrast. Mm-hmm. So you was trying to kind of put a contrast on the car. So when I got that car, I wanted to put wheels and bows on it, so I didn't even put elbows on it. I put wheels and bows.
But that was another set of wheels that was out popular during that time too, especially early.
Yeah, they was popular. So yeah. they was pretty much the fix to the elbow.
Yeah.
So elbow clacks. So Krager redesigned it so it wouldn't clack, so it didn't stick out.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't clack because that was the problem with elbows.
Yeah.
They started clacking. So if you sell somebody an 85 Eldorado, 84 with a brand new set of wheels, and they call you say I'm hearing a noise. Click, 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 click.
Mm.
Yeah, that's a problem that a Cadillac dealership can't have. They have to fix that problem.
Mm.
So I guess they redesigned the wheel. I could be wrong, but that's probably where Well Wheels came from. So I had a set of Wells on it, Wells and Vols. So, but before I put the Wells and Vols on it, I took my time, bought the Wells and Vols, but I wanted to put a top on it. So me just imagining what could I do different from what I had seen. I put a canary yellow rag top on it.
So it was a maroon car with canary yellow.
It had a canary yellow rag top on it.
What do people say when you put it together? Cause that's a bright, it's a different color contrast. But I heard that it was real clean back in the day.
Well, what people would say, hey, I'm gonna tell you what I said.
Yeah.
When I was working on the car, I dropped it off at Hicks Upholstery on 59. So I bought it, got ready to put the top on it, dropped it off at Hicks, and I was coming down 59 from Humble. And if you know where Hicks is located, kind of at Jensen 59, you can see it from the freeway.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm coming down the freeway and I look to the right and I see the car in there and them putting the top on the car. And it was yellow. I got scared.
Like yellow, yellow.
It was yellow, yellow.
Yeah.
I got scared. I said, I think I made a mistake.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the car from a distance, passed by on the freeway, the car burgundy, top canary yellow. It didn't look good.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't look good from the freeway. When I got ready to go pick the car up, I was nervous because when I pulled up, you got to think I'm looking at a car with factory wheels, no Vogue tires, no nothing on this burgundy with a canary yellow top.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a little spooked at that time. Honestly speaking, I was scared because I thought I had spent $450 on this rag top and I had wasted my money because I felt like I had messed my car up at that point.
Yeah.
But I had a vision in my head of what I wanted the car to look like, but it wasn't looking that way when I picked it up from the upholstery shop.
Yeah.
So I'm leaving the upholstery shop. I got butterflies in my stomach. I'm nervous. I'm kind of sweating. I'm kind of like, man, I can't believe I just spent $450 for this man to put this top on my car, and I may have to take this top off. Mm-hmm. But in the back of my mind, I was like, okay, the top yellow. I put the yellow top on it because I'm going to put a set of Vogues on it with a yellow stripe. I knew at that point I was going to paint my drums yellow. So I knew I was going to do my brake calipers. My brake calipers on the front yellow. It had drums in the back. I knew they was going to be yellow. We had a dude in the neighborhood named Kurt that used to pinstripe cars. So I knew I was going to take it to Kurt to get a yellow pinstripe put on it.
Now it's coming together how it looked in my head.
Well, I had to look at my head, but it wasn't on the car yet. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was going to look good, but I was nervous about it when I got it from the upholstery shop. Mm-hmm. I get to the house. So I'm in Scenic Woods on Parker. Me and Kim, one of my best friends, we jacking the car up. So if you're putting wheels on a car, you know it's a little work as far as you got to jack it up, put your legs under, lift the tires up, get the lug nuts right, get the washers right. So I'm painting my brake calipers, trying to get the car right. So I'm painting my brake calipers, sanding them down, you know, trying to paint them. While I'm doing this, some girls showed up that we went to school with, and they laughing.
Yeah.
They like, Ken, I can't believe you let your friend mess his car up like this.
Yeah.
So they saying that, I'm nervous, I'm scared, and then my daddy walk outside.
What'd he say?
Man, I don't cuss like this most of the time. My daddy said, I can't believe you just fucked that car up. So my dad walk outside, say I done messed the car up. The girls on my driveway telling me to call again.
Yeah.
So I'm nervous. So I tell them, look, if y'all don't have nothing good to say about the car, just leave. Don't leave, get away from me, because I'm frustrated at this point. Mm-hmm. So I'm frustrated because I know what's in my head, but I don't see it right now. But I tell them y'all need to leave. So they leave. So we live on a dead end. So my daddy get in his truck, go to the dead end. He make a U-turn because you got to come back out. He pull up on the other side of the street. He say, hey, man. I say, what's up? He say, hey, man, you going to need a goddamn clown suit to drive that car. So, man, so he laughing, and he pull off and leave.
Yeah.
So he leaves. So I'm trying to put the wheels on the car, paint the calipers, and my old man just told me I'm going to need a clown suit to drive.
Yeah.
So I'm not frustrated. I'm frustrated, but I'm just saying to myself, let me do what I think, and let's see how this is going to look when I get through.
Yeah.
So to make a long story short, put the wheels on, paint the calipers, put the wheels on the car, go take it to Kurt. Kurt pinstripe the car. Car looking totally different now, because now the whole color scheme coming together. So you got wheels, bows, you got yellow drums, you got yellow pinstripes. So I ride over to Alf Norman and go get a false gate, Rockford false gate sticker. It's yellow, so I put it on the back window. Mm-hmm. I didn't have no music in it yet. I had to work to get to that point, but I put the yellow stick on the back to color coordinate the burgundy and the yellow. Mm-hmm. So my old man pulled back up a couple of days later. He see the car. He like, man, that car look good.
Yeah.
So he changed his mind. He like, that car look, man, that look good.
Yeah.
So I'm knowing that it looks good. Couple of weeks, about a week later, the girl that was laughing called me. She lived in Norwood Mountain. She said, hey, Warren. I said, what's up? She said, can you do me a favor? I said, what? She said, can you bring that car over here? I want my mama to see it. Because everybody was talking about the car.
Yeah.
So I drove the car to Norwood Mountain. You know, she called her mom and dad outside. They looked at the car. They admired the car. And I mean, that was pretty much the gist of that car. I spent all my money on it that I had. I didn't buy no shoes, no clothes.
I didn't buy nothing.
Probably at that point, I was probably 18, 19 years old.
Okay.
So I didn't spend no money on nothing but my car.
Yeah.
I ain't had no Jordans, no nothing. I spent every dollar I had on that car.
What was people saying when they saw it? Because it's a different color contrast, you know, coming down the street. But like, what was people saying when they saw it?
Everybody saw the car, liked the car. I mean, the car was clean, the top was yellow, the car was burgundy, it had all the yellow trim on it, so it played together, so the car looked good. So everybody that saw the car, they acted like the car.
Yeah.
So it turned out to be, you know, a nice car. Now, what happened to that car, about eight, nine months later, when we graduated from high school, my friend went to Prairie View. Mm-hmm. And we went down to Prairie View when they do the home, when freshmen are coming in, they on the basketball court, and they got the DJ out there, so we was out there drinking, partying. But I wind up turning the car over on 290 in Huffmeister.
Okay.
So the car turned over, slid off the side of the freeway, and that was the end of that compass.
Okay.
Yeah.
Man. So tell me about the next cars you might have had, next one you might have had right after that, or the next one you fixed up. Because I know, you know, everybody knows you from having the Cadillac from back in the day. So just tell me about that.
The next car, so I took a car break for probably about 2 years. So I wound up getting a 72 Chevrolet I kind of fixed up and played with. In the meanwhile, my mother had an 85 Cadillac Coupe de Ville. So my daddy got rid of the Tarnata, he bought an 85 Cadillac Coupe de Ville off the showroom floor from Tom Peacock Cadillac. And if you know anything about the Cadillac dealership usually have guys that work there that work for Vogue. So they work for the Vogue department. So their job is to take, they work at Cadillac and Lincoln. So what they do, their job is to literally take factory cars, customize them, put a Vogue package on the car, and then sell the car with a Vogue package. Vogue package could be bumper kit, it could be a grill, it's gonna be Vogue tires, you know, rims and tires, Vogues, gold trim, anything that's accessories they can put on the car, they put it on the car so you can mark the car up to get more money for it, and plus the car look good, it's sitting on the showroom floor. So he bought a Cadillac for my mama that was dressed out, ready to go. The only negative, it had a set of BBSs on it. So it had Vogue tires, BBS wheels. It was a good looking car. Mm-hmm. So what happened to that car, if anybody know about 85 Cadillac Coupe de Ville, they came with a 4.1 motor. So after about 3 or 4 years of her having that car, the motor went out. She took it to Thunderbolt, got the motor totally redone. Thunderbolt redid the motor. That 4100 lasted about a year, and the motor messed up again. So she was frustrated with the car, so she didn't want it no more. So she wound up buying another car. She told me I can have a car. It wasn't running. It needed a motor again. So I took the car, and at that particular point, I didn't want to put another 4100 in it because I knew they wasn't good motors. It would be equivalent to somebody buying a North Star right now. North Star had a lot of issues. They really not good motors. 4100 was the same way.
Yeah.
So I took that car off of 45 and they put a 4.5 in it. So I got the guy to put a 4.5 motor in it, which came in the 87, 88 Cadillac, the same car, but Cadillac put a better motor in it. So a 4.5 is a good motor. So took the 4100 out, put the 4.5 in it. So put a 4.5 in it. The car had a factory grill on it. The car had a bumper kit on the back of it. And it was a good looking car. All the car really needed was a set of wheels on it. So the way that we get to back to the wheels that I put on this car, when I told you we had an 84 Oldsmobile Tarnata,
yeah.
And when I told you my daddy did an insurance job on the car, I didn't know the guy that he dealt with was a friend that worked with him. He had those wheels in Crosby.
Brand new set, you know, from that time, from 84.
So you would say a brand new set of 84s that the insurance company bought back in 84, they was brand new wheels. Car guy, they did an insurance job on the car. He take a brand new set of wheels off his 84 Oldsmobile. From my understanding, they buried the car somewhere in Crosby, Texas, and he put the wheels in his attic. So they was brand new. I didn't know he still had those wheels. And just in passing, me and my daddy was talking about something one day, and I was telling him I was gonna put some wheels on that car. And he told me the guy still had those wheels from 1984. And this might have been 92. This might have been 1992. At that particular point, you couldn't find no wheels. If you had to buy them, you had to buy them off the street.
Yeah.
And if you bought them off the street, they wasn't, you know, most of them wasn't good looking wheels.
Yeah.
They wasn't clean, they had issues, so you kind of had to piece together wheels to try to get you a good set of wheels.
You basically had a set of elbows back then that was brand new, barely rolled on, while everybody, you know, riding on wheels that might be 8 years old.
Pretty much you could say that.
Yeah.
So when I found out he had the wheels, he didn't know what they was worth.
Yeah.
I don't remember at the time what they would have been worth, but I'm gonna say they might have been worth about $1,500 to $2,000 on the street.
Yeah.
So come to find out he had the wheels, he didn't know what they was worth. He told my dad to tell me, cause he knew me, he said, tell me, give me $300 for the wheels. So I get four brand new elbows for $300. So I go, you know, buy a brand new set of Vogues, put on the car, and I was and at that particular time I had a detail shop down here at this location. So I had a detail shop, we washing cars down here. So a guy stayed down the street named Fred Love that graduated with my brother, me and him was pretty tight. So
he put together calls too.
Yeah, so he was putting together calls, playing with calls. We down there talking in his backyard. And he got an elbow sitting in the backyard that's just as clean as my elbows, but it was a clacker. So it made noise. It was a wheel that was clacking, but it was a clean wheel. And I was like, dude, what you gonna do with that wheel? He said, oh, nothing. Why, what's up? And I said, I think I wanna put that in my bumper kit. So I said, I think I wanna take that wheel and put it in my bumper kit. So he was like, you can have a wheel. So he gave me the wheel, and we was talking about it, and he told me about a guy down the street. White guy named Skiles Customs. Was down in Homestead. Cause mind you, yeah, we in Rosewood, I'm from Homestead, that's down the street, so I didn't know about Mr. Skiles. So he told me about him, so we went down there to Mr. Skiles. So on that bumper kit, he took the top piece off of the bumper kit. So he took the top piece off, he said, leave me the wheel, just leave me the top part, and I'm gonna see what I can do for you. So I told him what I wanted, so I said, I wanna put this wheel in this bumper kit, because at that particular time, I had the four wheels on the car. The car had a gold package on it. It had a custom grill, a Vogue grill on it. It had a bumper kit,
and it had the top. Just to put the vision in the viewer's mind, what color was the car?
The car was beige.
Yeah.
So it was a beige car with a gold package.
Yeah.
With gold brake calipers, with four elbows on it with gold two balls.
So it looked like, because I heard about the car and they said that back in the day, it just looked like a gold block just coming down the street.
They call it like a bar of gold, basically. Yeah. It looked like a bar of gold. Yeah. So what happened, when put the wheels on the car, took the bumper kit down at a Skiles so he can put the bumper kit in it. And by the time, it took him a couple of weeks to figure out how to do that wheel because nobody had did that. Mm-hmm. So back then, we would ride the MLK every now and then. So we ride the MLK, so you probably heard of Toast. So yeah. Toast had a Seville. So he had a wheel in his trunk.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure he didn't go buy that trunk. I'm pretty sure his Seville probably came with the hubcap in the trunk.
Yeah.
And he put a wheel in the trunk. Mm-hmm. Nobody really had bumper kits as far as nobody was focused on bumper kits because there wasn't a lot of cars that probably had them. Wasn't nobody paying attention to them.
Yeah.
So he had five wheels on his car. He had four on the floor. He had one in the trunk.
Yeah. So when you're saying on the trunk, you're saying literally on the trunk, not bumper kit. Not
yeah, no bumper kit. He just had it in the trunk.
Yeah.
So if you got some Sevilles come with the wheel in the trunk, mm-hmm. and then you got most of them don't have a wheel on the trunk.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty sure he just took his hubcap out, put a wheel in the trunk on that yeah. car. So I had seen his car. You know, everybody had seen it, but I wasn't really thinking about it. So it was just me saying, I got this bumper kit. I need to put a wheel in it. Because it just seemed like it would make sense to do that.
Yeah.
So we took it to Mr. Skiles, and Mr. Skiles took that wheel, and he couldn't really figure out how to cut it, so he cut it. You know how you got a rim? So he sliced the wheel in half. Mm-hmm. So he sliced it in half, and he was trying to put the whole 15-inch wheel in the bumper kit. Mm-hmm. And he called me and said, nah, I sliced it, but that's not going to work. I don't think I can do it like that, because let me play with it some more and see how I can figure out how to do it.
Yeah.
So he called me maybe 3-4 days later. He said, hey, I figured out what to do with it.
Yeah.
I said, what you did? He said, come down here, let me show you. So I went down there. He had took that elbow 15 inches, though. Mm-hmm. It's a 15-inch wheel. So he took that center wheel. That center wheel is 14 inches on the inside.
Okay.
So he cut out the elbow. He cut the ring of that elbow out and threw the rim part away.
Yeah.
He took out just that ring that's got the spokes. And he cut that out, and he said, guess what? He said, this 14 inches. And he said, guess what? That hubcap and that bumper kit 14 inches.
So it fit perfect.
So he popped the hubcap out of the bumper kit, put the wheel in the bumper kit, and he threaded the back of the wheel so you could put screws in it.
Yeah.
And he threaded it so it looked like it came from the factory like yeah. that. And then I put a gold tube on it, so I had five wheels with a gold tube on it. And when I went down there and we put it on the car, I leave down Homestead and come back to the detail shop right here.
Yeah.
And I pull up at the detail shop. And you got to know what the detail shop, you got D-boys hanging out, everybody hanging out. And they look at the car and they like, man, you tripping. It's like super fly pimp stuff, you know.
Because this car was, it was ahead of its time because nobody really had bumper kits like that.
Well, when they saw the bumper kit, they say, that's pimp shit.
Yeah.
You tripping. man, you tripping. Where you get that idea from to put that wheel back down? I was like, well, I mean, you would think it needed a wheel if I had four of them on the car and I got a hubcap in the back. I need to put the wheel in the back to make it part of the four wheels that's on the ground. So, and I laughed, I'll never forget, that was Sean, dude named Box. Mm-hmm. So Box was like, man, you tripping. Mm-hmm. Like, it's soulful.
Yeah.
But it looked good, but he said it was soulful.
Yeah.
So I pulled out, left riding, and everybody that saw the car were tripping on it because it was clean.
I remember you telling me a story that you had rolled, I think you said you rolled down MLK before you put it on, and you heard somebody say, man, that car clean, if he got a bumper, and they saw like the bottom of the bumper kit, mm-hmm. and they was like, man, if he got a bumper kit, he really killing.
Well, what happened, we riding through Martin Luther King Park.
Yeah.
So we riding through the park, I got four wheels on the floor, gold, two bars, car clean.
Yeah.
Mr. Skiles had the top piece.
Yeah.
So the dudes looking at the car, and they like, man, if this car got a bumper kit on it, Lord, like, it's over.
Yeah.
But it was, the bottom was on there, but the top wasn't on. The next week, when I came back through there, the top was on, mm-hmm. with the bumper kit in it, with the elbow in it.
Yeah. Yeah, and tell me about the importance of when you put your bumper kit on, because, you know, during this time, it was in the early 90s, and like you were saying, Toast's car really was the only, kind of like the only one that the people kind of knew with another wheel on the trunk, bumper kit or a wheel on the trunk. So tell me the importance of how your car kind of meant, you know, for this side. I know you said for this side, you know,
right.
It meant a lot. So just tell me what it meant.
Well, I guess at that particular time, like I say, people said it was soulful and it didn't look right. So I guess at that particular time, I kind of noticed the shift, because at that particular time, people wasn't concentrating on grills and bumper kits. Mm-hmm. That wasn't a part of what you had to have on the car. After that particular car, that became a part of the package. So it would be like, if I'm gonna fix a car up and do what I'm gonna do to it, I need to make sure I got a grill on it, and I need to make sure I got a bumper kit on it. So what happened after that car was on the road for about 30 days, people started raiding the junkyards for bumper kits and grills. So it was kind of an influx of people starting to buy bumper kits and grills. So I pulled up at Mr. Clark's place over on 610 one day, by maybe a month or two after I had, you know, put the wheel on the car. I was going over there to get a two bar or something, because he sold Krager caps, two bars. And I was going over there to get something. And when I pulled up, everybody was over there trying to get bumper kits and get grills put on cars. They was trying to put cars together that had to have that on the package deal. So I'm not saying it was the first car with a bumper kit. I don't know, but I know on this side of town that it was possibly the first car that probably had a bumper, you know, actual bumper kit that guys started putting on them cars to say that that was a part of what needed to be on your car to kind of complete your car. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So the car kind of was ahead of its time, really.
I would say it was kind of ahead of its time as far as the package. Mm-hmm. I would say the package of what we know as a slab now, that would be a part of the package. Now, it didn't have pop trunk. It didn't have music in it. It just had the outside package. So if you would say that I got to have wheels, the factory paint was clean, so it wasn't candy paint. It was factory paint.
Yeah. And then really,
wheels and gold package.
Really, during this time, I mean, just for me doing my research, I don't think this pop trunk was really just a must back then.
I don't think at that particular time it was.
Because it was so early.
I don't remember right, but I think pop trunk was after that. So I think people started popping trunks after that. You know, bumper kits hanging and putting pumps on bumper kits and all that. But at that particular time, bumper kit wasn't a part of the car. So if you had a car, the bumper kit probably wasn't going to be something you was looking for. A grill maybe, but definitely probably not a bumper kit.
Okay.
The elbow in it.
Yeah.
So the car was clean, and you know, as a guy that didn't play in the streets, so I wasn't a D-boy.
Yeah.
So I was just the guy that literally, I enjoy messing with cars. Mm-hmm. I like fixing them up, I like playing with them, I like messing with it. I knew at that point when I put that car together, my daddy did something that was kind of funny, you would think. Mm-hmm. He gave me a pistol. Mm-hmm. So when he saw that car with them wheels on it and that bumper kit, he said, hey man, they taking this car from you. Mm-hmm. He said, they taking this car from you.
Have any altercations or somebody trying to take your car from you?
Well, when he said that, he gave me a 32 automatic Browning target pistol. Mm-hmm. So you got to think, the car had to be clean. because I wasn't even old enough to be to carry a pistol, mm-hmm. but he gave me a pistol. Mm-hmm. So at this particular point, I understood what I had on the car, and I knew I needed a pistol because I knew that the car was clean. I knew it was, you know, you couldn't buy the wheels. I had a clean set of wheels, and word was getting out on the street, I cleaned my wheels where it was. Because
mm-hmm. it was one of the cleanest cars during that time on this side of town, at least.
Well, the car was clean, I knew it was clean, because one day, I mean, we sitting there on for Thanksgiving, and I got two D-boys show up at my mama house, and they wanted to buy my car. Mm-hmm. They count that money on the porch, how much you want for this car.
So you knew like you was going to eventually have a car one day.
Well, I just knew I wasn't going to sell the car, but I knew that the car, the word had got around the street, the car was clean, people had seen the car. I knew my wheels was clean, I knew you couldn't buy these wheels. Mm-hmm. So I knew I had a set of prized wheels, and I knew I had a clean car at that particular point in time. Mm-hmm. So I knew that I was probably going to run into some trouble.
Did you?
Yeah, I did.
What happened in that situation?
When you riding on wheels, and they didn't make them, so the only way you can get them, you had to take them. Mm-hmm. People was carjacking. It was stuff people had heard about. I didn't really know nobody point blank that they had got carjacked, but I knew it was a real thing. Yeah. So whenever I would be in the car, I knew what I was in. Mm-hmm. So I'd have to ride with my pistol in my lap. And you had to take it serious because you knew that you had a vehicle and you had some wheels that probably somebody may want to take. Mm-hmm. So we were sitting in Fontaine one day. We was getting ready to go to the club, and we was getting ready to go. And my partner asked me, Ken asked me, he was like, man, do you have your gun cocked and loaded? You know, when you're riding with it? And I was like, yeah, I keep my gun cocked and loaded. If I'm going to get caught carrying a pistol illegally, hey, I might as well at least have it cocked and ready. Mm-hmm. So I used to keep my pistol tucked under my driver's seat. So if you know about a car, you know how where the leather tuck, if you reach on the bottom, the leather tuck. So I used to tuck it in there to where I could push it, but it would fall in my hand. Mm-hmm. So I could reach under my seat, push my pistol. My pistol would fall in my hand. Mm-hmm. It was, I'd click my safety off and it was ready to shoot. Mm-hmm. So, ironically, the same night I said that, we go to the club, we hanging out. I don't know if it was Palladium, Chocolate Town, but it was on 45 Park. So we at the club hanging out, the club lit out, everybody go to 2 Pesos or whatever it was called on 45 and Tidwell. So we hanging out, the parking lot full of people, you know, full of cars, everybody hanging out, riding, talking to girls, having fun. And, you know, at that time, it was 4 of us in the car. My car was a 2-door. Mm-hmm. So we riding in the car. I got a pistol on my side. Ken got a pistol on the passenger side. But he's in the back seat behind me. I got my friend Derek and Sherrod on the passenger side. Mm-hmm. So they from Fontaine, all 3 of them. Mm-hmm. So we riding in the parking lot. We hanging out. It's probably 3 in the morning. We paying attention, mm-hmm. but we not really paying attention. You know, there's girls on the other side of us. They talking to us, so everybody focused on the car next to us because these girls talking, mm-hmm. they talking to girls, we talking. And I happen to look up and I see 2 guys walking by Walgreens. There's Walgreens in the parking lot. And I see the front of the pistol come up and I see the back of the pistol go back. Mm-hmm. I said, them dudes got a pistol. But I didn't think they was finna mess with me, but I thought they was finna start shooting or acting a fool in the parking lot. So not knowing they was gonna mess with me, some tell me to get my pistol. So I lean over, we talking. I reach to the side, I push my pistol, I push it, it fall in my hand. Something tell me to click the safety off. I'm not looking to my left, but I click my safety off, but I'm leaning over because I'm leaning over in the car with my, you know, my hand in the back seat getting my pistol. When I come up, we talking, it's a gun to my head. Somebody say, get out this mother sucker before I kill all 4 of y'all. So when he say that, I'm thinking, this somebody playing, because I'm not getting my pistol for that. I'm getting my pistol because I just think they finna start shooting, acting a fool in the parking lot. So when I hear that, I'm thinking it's a friend. Say, hey, fool, get out this car, you know, playing with me. So when I reach up, when I sit up straight, all I see is the gun to my head. And I just remember at that point saying, give me a minute to get out the car. And he didn't know I had a pistol. So when I got out the car, I just started shooting. So I got out the car, which I thought I unloaded the clip. Mm-hmm. So it was 6-7 bullets in there. I didn't know how many bullets I shot, but I could have swore I shot all of them. Come to find out, I shot 3 times. Mm-hmm. I pointed at his chest. I don't know if I hit him, what I hit, but I got tunnel vision. And I was mad because I'm saying to myself, I'm not gonna allow nobody to take nothing from me. It was probably stupid, but I just don't like nobody taking nothing from me. Mm-hmm. So it was more the fact I can't believe the dude put a pistol on me, try to take my car from me. So I get out the car, I turn, I shoot three times, and then I hear somebody yell across the top of the car. And Ken is over there. Ken get out the car. He's sitting behind me. He fell when he got out the car. And he said, oh, that's them. That's you shooting them. He thought the guy was shooting me because it happened so fast. My two partners on the passenger side literally walked from I-45 to Fontaine. They walked home that night. Yeah. So they got out, ran. Ken was getting out the run. I'm shooting. And I hear somebody else yell. So I come across the top of the car. And I'm about to shoot at them because I'm thinking that somebody's still telling me to get away from this car. Mm-hmm. So I come across, draw down on them, and Ken tell me that was HPD laws. Mm-hmm. So now I'm in a parking lot with HPD laws. I shot three times, and I got my gun pulled on the laws. Mm-hmm. So I throw my pistol down. When he tell Mr. Cops, I throw it down, lay on the ground. And naturally, hey, I'm thinking my future is messed up because I got to eat. Hey, I'm finna get a pistol case.
Yeah.
And I was shooting.
Yeah.
So, the cops come over there. They aggravated because they telling me we finna go to jail for attempted murder on a police officer. They telling me we finna go to jail for this, go to jail for that. You can tell they were scared because I literally was pointing my pistol at them. Mm-hmm. I think the reason they didn't shoot me because Ken was standing by them. He had a pistol. He threw it down, but he wasn't posing a threat. I was posing a threat, but I threw my gun down. Mm-hmm. So, we wind up. So, I'm listening to this young guy. It's a young cop, white cop. And he said, hey man, do you know what kind of pistol that is you threw? And I'm like, yeah, that's a 32 automatic Brown and Target pistol. That's a collector's item. But he said, it's not the type of pistol you throw around.
Yeah.
I say, sir, if I get out of this, I don't never want to see that pistol again. Because I'm listening to him, and I can tell the way he's talking, he want that pistol. You get me?
Yeah.
So he want the pistol.
Yeah.
So Ken got a pawn shop pistol that ain't worth nothing. I got a collector's item pistol. So we get in the back seat of the car, everything died on. They say, we gonna call, see if anybody showed up, shot at the hospital. So they called to see if anybody showed up, shot. Nobody showed up, shot. I don't know if I shot the guy. Don't know if I hit him, don't know nothing. So he hang the phone up and say, hey, today y'all lucky day. Didn't nobody show up, shot. I'ma call the DA. I'ma see if I can get y'all a PI charge, a public intoxication charge.
Good.
So I'm sitting in the back seat, handcuffed, Ken handcuffed. And we sitting back there, and Ken done cussed the laws out acting a fool. But we sitting back there, I'm like, dude, calm down, we may get out of this here. Mm-hmm. So the law called the DA. He said, I got two guys in a car that they just tried to get carjacked. But nobody got shot from what we know. We called the hospital, and he got some wheels on his car that probably changed hands 5 or 6 times that they take. Mm-hmm. So they were trying to take his car. I want to know if I can give him a PI charge. I guess the DA said yes. He hung the phone up. And when he hung the phone up, he told us, I'm going to take y'all to jail for about 5 or 6 hours. You know, y'all will be out about 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning. And he said, your pistols will be in the property room.
Man, so how did you transition from riding on elbows to actually starting to opening the car lot?
Hold on 1 second. I ain't finished telling you about this. So when I get to the house, the next day, my daddy said, where my pistol? Mm-hmm. I said, man, I told the cops they had that pistol. I told him I ain't want to see that pistol no more. He said, you crazy. I want my pistol. It took my daddy about 6 months. About 4 months to get that pistol back. Because that pistol never showed up in the private room. The cop never turned that pistol in. He
kept it for himself.
He kept it, but I guess my daddy was so persistent about getting it, he met that cop on the side of the freeway and got that pistol back about 4 months later. And I still got that one to this day. Now, what was the other question?
My question was just, how did you transition from riding on elbows to starting a shop, opening up a shop on Homestead?
Man, that was, after having that car, getting the pistol pulled, you know, pulled on me for the wheels, I rode them wheels probably another 6 months. Mm-hmm. It was fun, but it kind of took the fun out of it. You know, being carjacked, somebody trying to carjack you, pulling a pistol in the face. At that particular point, I had got married, and you was on the way.
Yeah.
So your mama was pregnant with you, so I made a decision at that point to pretty much take the wheels off the car, sell the car. We had got an apartment, and we was in the process of trying to get a house. So I made a decision to keep the wheels, but I gave the fifth wheel, because I kept all my wheels, I sold the car, I kept the four wheels and I kept the wheel that went inside the bumper kit. I gave the bumper kit to my partner named Chad, the wheel that goes in the bumper kit, because he was trying to remake the wheels. So he was trying to remake elbows. So he wanted that wheel to get the measurements of the spokes and get the whole layout of the wheel so he could try to get somebody to redesign that wheel. So I gave him that, and then I took the other four wheels, but I had all the wheels chained up in Acres Home. I had all the wheels chained up with the bumper kit wheel on top, locked up, chained up, so if somebody got in the house, they couldn't take all the wheels out. But he wound up getting the bumper kit, and then I was thinking about getting my dealer license to buy and sell cars. So I called Ken one day, and I sold him them wheels for $1,000. I say, look, man, I'm going to sell you these wheels. They work more than what I'm going to sell them to you for, but you my partner, but I'm going to sell you these wheels because I'm going to sell these wheels. And dealer license cost about $1,000 to get them, so I sold the wheels for $1,000, and I got my dealer license to buy and sell cars at that point.
So how did Rosewood, you know, this Rosewood, just back in them days, it's literally during this time that you getting ready to start this car lot over here, it was notorious for jacking, for, you know, cars, and then slabs, you know, you was selling, you know, you stopped riding them personally, but you was fixing up cars, having Eldorados and putting wheels on them over here. So how did Rosewood react to you not being from Rosewood, being from Senecawood, opening a shop in Rosewood, selling cars?
Well, that was more of a process because I had washed cars down here from this location. So I knew some people in Rosewood. Like I met Fred Love, I knew Fred Love, I met Charlie, because Charlie was helping us. Charlie Mosley was helping me with the car wash. So I had already met guys from Rosewood. So when I came down here to start the car lot, I had already had relationships down here, but Rosewood pretty much gave me a pass. So with me coming down here saying, hey, I'm gonna start a car lot, which I knew a lot of the guys from down here, but it was more the fact, you're gonna start a car lot. So Rosewood was kind of, the area was excited about it. So it's kind of like you got somebody saying, I'm gonna start a car lot, I'm gonna start it over here. Then the people kind of saying, I'm gonna get this dude a pass, because we just, because we trying to see what he trying to do. So, you know, before I started the car lot, you know, working, trying to figure out how to get money, doing business plans, the Small Business Administration told me that a car lot wouldn't work in this area. So they basically said a car lot wouldn't work. I felt like a car lot would work over here because I had been selling cars from high school. And I had sold some cars when I had the car wash down here. So I had sold cars out here, not many, but every time I would buy a car and stick it down there, it was easy to sell. So that was me saying, hey, I know it'll work. And then my daddy had rented this place to a guy that sold cars a long time ago. He didn't sell a lot of cars, but I knew when I was in high school, I watched that guy, and I said if he had kept cars on that lot, he probably could have sold cars and did pretty good. Yeah. So Rosewood, you know, it was a blessing because they gave me a pass. They allowed me to come over here. They spent money with me. They did business with me. And it was just a matter of transitioning from trying to figure out how to run a car lot, how to sell cars, you know, so it was a process.
Yeah. Well, was you hearing about Rosewood during this time?
I mean, not to the point the way you would think. I grew up in Senecawood, so it wasn't like we looked at Rosewood and it was like Rosewood doing this, Rosewood doing that. We didn't, you know, Rosewood was just another neighborhood over here. So it wasn't something, like I guess the guys that grew up in Rosewood may have known a whole lot of stuff that was going on in Rosewood, and I guess some of the certain guys from certain neighborhoods and area may have knew about car stealing and all the stuff that was going on because of all the shops back in the days that sold, you know, that sold stolen parts off of cars, seats, tailgates, wheels, and factory wheels. So it was a lot of money being made back in the 80s off of stealing cars. So, you know, people that knew about Rosewood would know it, but it wasn't like that we looked at Rosewood and it was just something that we talked about a lot, because it was just a neighborhood like North Fort Manor, Senecawood, Fontaine. We was, you know, just another neighborhood on this side of town.
And, you know, your shop is really known for selling good quality cars, but another thing that it was known for back in the day was, you know, you fixing up cars. And people could come down here and it would be a whole bunch of Cadillacs fixed up on wheels, all gold tires on it. So just tell me where you got the concept of that from.
I would say the concept of that came from, it's kind of like what I told you about the guy that worked at Vogue. So they had a guy worked at Vogue at Tom Peacock back in the 80s named Maurice. So if you ever went to the Cadillac dealership, if you go to any Cadillac dealership, you got guys that literally fix up cars. Mm-hmm. So me kind of seeing a car, so they would take a car and do everything to the car and sell it, because that allowed them to get more money for the car. Mm-hmm. So if you selling cars and you trying to figure out what can I do to a car to make it sell, the nicer the car is, the better the car look, the easier it is to sell. Mm-hmm. So if you could buy a car, let's say for $5,000, add another $2,000 worth of accessories to it, rims, Vogue tires, Vogue grill, and you can do things to the car to help the car sell faster, then you force people to buy it because they're looking at a car and it's so clean and it looks so good, they willing to go out on buy it versus a factory car with nothing on it. Mm-hmm. So it was just more to, you know, slowly buying cars, selling cars, slowly getting plugged into different places. I got plugged into David Taylor Cadillac for about 10 years. I was able to go straight to David Taylor Cadillac and buy Cadillacs. Mm-hmm. So I was literally buying a lot of trade-ins. So I would get up every day and go to David Taylor Cadillac 2-3 times a week and see what cars got traded in. So naturally, if I'm going to a Cadillac dealership, I'm looking at Cadillacs. So every Cadillac they got on trade, I had action at buying those Cadillacs. So I, you know, formed a relationship with a guy named Jesse that works for Vogue at Cadillac. So I would get a deal on the tires. I started dipping the chrome wheels, sending the wheels. He turned me on to the people in California to where I could take factory wheels, get those wheels dipped chrome for about $400. I could buy the Vogue classic caps, the caps to go on the wheels. I could buy a grill. I could buy pillar posts. I could buy vents. I started finding out all the accessories that I could buy to put on a car. So that way, when a person bought a car, they didn't have to do anything but drive it off the car lot and it looked good. So that was more of something that happened over time. That was more of a process of getting in business, buying cars, getting access at certain cars, and then trying to figure out how can I make this car sell faster and how can I profit from the car. Yeah. So if you put accessories on it, you can mark it up a little bit more.
And then, you know, the thing was back then, if you want to put a car together, you know, come to WB's and he gonna already have you right there. All you gotta do, if he don't have the wheels on it, buy the wheels, and that's it, really.
Right.
So just tell me about the, because it's a picture that's around on the internet, you know, it's on the WB's page of two Eldorados and Elante, you know, just all the Eldorados you had. Just tell me about them.
Well, and I mean,
with actual elbows on it.
Well, to think about that, that was more of a, those cars, early back when eBay first started, you can get on eBay and buy cars. Mm-hmm. So the internet was jumping. You can get on the internet and find any car you want. So me being a car enthusiast, liking cars, I could get on eBay and I can say, I want a Cadillac Eldorado. I could type in Cadillac Eldorado and you can find all the ones in the United States.
Yeah.
So at that particular point in time, you could buy an 84, 85 Cadillac Eldorado, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000. That was ice water. I'm talking about the car looked brand new.
Low mileage,
perfect interior, top in great shape, bumper kit on the car already. Yeah. So those cars came about by being online, knowing that we had a market in Houston for cars like that, knowing people wanted those cars, being able to transport them from another state. You get online, you bid on the car, you buy the car, you transport the car to Houston. At that particular time, wheels was hard, so buying a set of elbows, you had to go to Mr. Davis. Mm-hmm. So you would have to go to Mr. Davis, buy a set of wheels, pay a lot of money for those wheels. Mm-hmm. I got lucky. I sold the guy that's connected to the new wheels they started making, I sold his brother a car. Mm-hmm. So when I sold his brother a car, I happened to be at the tire shop on Jensen, and his brother pulled up with one of the cars he bought from me with some elbows on it. Mm-hmm. And they look brand new. I'm like, man, where you get them wheels from? So he said, hey, my brother remaking these wheels. This is the prototype. They told me to ride the wheels, see how they was gonna do and see what they was gonna do. And I'm like, so somebody remaking these wheels? So he asked me if I wanted to buy them. I said, yeah, I want to buy those wheels. Mm-hmm. So he came to the shop. We go over to two brothers. He take the wheels off the car and he sell me the wheels. I forgot what I might have paid for. I don't know what he sold them to me for. It might have been $1,500, $1,800. Mm-hmm. It was a fat number.
Yeah.
I say, can I get some more? He said, yeah. So I say, send me two more sets. So they sent me two more sets. They was 83s. Mm-hmm. What the soft side called, so for us, that the 83s, they called foes. It was the ones that Mr. Davis was getting $10,000 for.
Yeah.
So I get three sets of these wheels, and I don't even think at this point anybody knew they was remaking those wheels. Mm,
they so, just was driving by like, man, he got three sets of brand new Elvos out there, when not knowing that it's they out there remaking these wheels.
Well, the reason
this was the beginning.
Yeah, it was the beginning, and we was getting ready to do a Street Flavor video. We was getting ready to do Street Flavor. So we was getting ready to do Street Flavor. We had got the cars in. I didn't think I was gonna have some wheels to put on the cars, but the wheels fell right in my lap. So we was able to put wheels on, you know, on three cars. We did the Street Flavor thing. DeSolo came out. We had the cars ready. After we got through with those cars, we wound up selling those cars. And we bought more wheels because we had action at getting some wheels. So we bought some more sets of those wheels, and we wound up getting about four 1997 Cadillac Eldorados that was convertibles that we shipped. I think we shipped two of them in out of Florida, and I think the other two came from out of Chicago. Mm-hmm. So we bought the newer, you know, a newer Eldorado convertibles, and one of them had three of them had the tops where you had to buckle them in, and then the other one had the top that fold back in the trunk. So we was able to get four, you know, Eldorado 1996,
97 L dollars. Did you consider selling the wheels at any point in time? Because, you know, you selling the car, you know, you could have been, you know, the person that everybody on the north side came and got wheels from.
Well, I was asked to sell those wheels when we bought those wheels. Mm-hmm. At that particular point in time, I didn't want to sell them. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel like the headache. You got to think, I'm older. So, you know, when you start dealing with those wheels, I understood it was going to be a babysitting job. Mm-hmm. So for me, selling wheels, being in a position where I got to deal with those wheels every day, that's not what I wanted to do, because I didn't want the headache that came along with the wheels. So I understood you got a new wheel coming out on the street they can make. People going to want them. It's going to be a lot of heat on anybody's back that's selling those wheels. Mm-hmm. So I knew it was going to be a headache to get them out on the street. So I didn't want to be the contact person to start selling those wheels, because I didn't want the headache. I didn't want the headache in my life of trying to sell those wheels. You got to think, if I got a pistol pulled in my face behind those wheels, and then, you know, 8, 9 years later or 10 years later, somebody asking me, do I want to sell them? I didn't really want to sell them because I didn't want to deal with that headache. And I know how dangerous that those wheels could be.
Yeah. Yeah. You ever think about putting the car together again?
Man, when you get to my age, hey, I'm 49 years old.
You got this clean Mustang in the back.
I mean, to put together another car, I wouldn't say I put the car all the way together. So when you start talking about putting together a car, I deal with numbers all the time with dealing with cars. So for me to invest $40,000-$50,000 in putting together a car the right way, I probably wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Unless I ran into a great deal on a car. Yeah. If I ran into a great deal on a car to where I felt like I can put that car together, do it some justice, I would probably consider.
Yeah.
I'd probably consider. It'd have to be a convertible.
Yeah.
And it'd have to be something that I don't see a lot of.
Yeah. And then, you know, you rode during the time when it, I don't want to say it don't matter now, but during the time when it really mattered, you know, so you don't see the excitement in it probably either, you know what I'm saying? And then you got the clean Mustang back there. You know, I don't know if y'all can see it.
Well, like I said, being almost 50 years old, I don't go nowhere. So if I put together a car, the chances of me going places and showing off and really get a chance to enjoy it would be limited. So I really wouldn't get a chance to really enjoy it like I would have in my younger days.
Okay. Yeah. This is a good interview, man. Tell them how they can get at you. You know, you still selling cars, you know, down here on Homestead and Carruthers, you know. What's the phone number, you know, address, you know.
Yeah, this WB's Used Auto Sales, 7815 Homestead. You can call us at 713-633-3131. The website is wbauto.com. And right now, we low on inventory. You know, we're not fixing up cars like we used to by far because of age and time. But if you want a good quality car, we can try to sell you one. Peace out.
SlabOGsTV. Peace out for the next one.